And I would like to tell you about a subject that is interesting. I sort of fell into it without wanting it. I'm not a complex analyst by any means. I sort of learned it with tears as I went along. But it has geometric and mechanical implications that are quite remarkable. So I'm going to start with a classical theorem of Poincaré in 1901, a theorem in mechanics. It's a very strange paper of Poincaré. He doesn't quote anybody. He never quotes his own papers again, ever. Doesn't give any motivation, and doesn't say why he did it. So there it is. So this is what Poincaré has done, and in fact, you see here Lie algebras and everything, and you can imagine that Poincaré didn't do Lie algebras, but actually he did. He used SO3, but the only intellectual achievement in replacing Poincaré by this is replacing SO3 by G. There is nothing else. Everything is in the paper, completely abstractly formulated. So here is what Poincaré did. He wanted to understand what happens if you have symmetry in a variational principle. And this turns out to be, this has turned today out into an industry. I will tell you two words about it later. So this is the situation. It's clearly a very special situation in which the configuration space of a mechanical system is a Lie group. And I have a Lagrangian function, which is on the state space, Tg. And then I restrict to the tangent space to the identity. That's my notation for the Lie algebra, as usual, German G. And then the statement that Poincaré did is that four things are equivalent. G of t is a curve, and then I take its derivative, and I take and bring it back to the identity. Now I get a curve in the Lie algebra, xi of t. Or I do it on the other way around. I'm obsessed with right versus left, because in continuum mechanics, this is extremely important. This is the so-called convective versus the spatial representation in fluids or in elasticity, etc., in liquids, crystals, etc. And there are relative sign changes that are important. But anyway, for us, it's going to be very simple. So he says the following. The following are equivalent. G of t satisfies the Euler-Lagrange equations for L on G. The variational principle of Hamilton holds. This is nothing new. This is Hamilton. This doesn't tell us anything new. Has nothing to do with the Lie group, right? But now comes Poincaré. The so-called equations that today are called the Euler-Poincaré equations hold. D over dt del L del xi equal to plus or minus L star xi del L del xi. Plus is for left, minus is for right. And del L del xi is, I use physicist notation, is just the Fréchet derivative of L. So this is an element in G star. Or the Euler-Poincaré variational principle holds delta of integral from A to B L of xi of t dt equal to zero. Holds for variations of a very special type, delta xi equal to eta dot plus minus xi eta, where eta t is an arbitrary path in G that vanishes at the endpoints. Now let's see what is the content of the theorem. One is equivalent to two. Hamilton knew this, that there is nothing to prove. Let's prove that three is equivalent to four. But this is also totally trivial. I mean, we can in fact do it in our head. That's how easy it is. Imagine that you take this derivative. What do you get? Delta del L del xi times delta xi. Replace delta xi by this, integrate by parts here, and you are going to get some expression, which is exactly this minus that, times eta. And since eta is arbitrary, that vanishes at the endpoints, like in calculus of variations, you conclude that the other factor is zero. So you get this equation, and the other way around. So this is trivial. Now let's see why are the 1, 2 equivalent to 3, 4? Well, even here it's almost obvious. If L is left invariant, for example, I multiply here by g minus 1, and then I don't have to write it. And then I write g minus 1 g dot, which is called xi. So I get the integrand is the same, right? So what is the content of the theorem, right? There is a content to the theorem, and the content is, well, it has to wake up. Come on, wake up. Here we go. And the content is here. It's not a standard variational principle. It's a constrained variational principle. And where does this come from? Even this is not difficult, by the way. Poincaré's paper is a page and a half. and everything is proved. Even this is easy, and I can tell you, but it's not, you can't do it in your head. I can tell you where it comes from. When you do the variational principle here, you have to take curves g of t, and you have to vary the curves, keeping the endpoints fixed, right? So you have another parameter, the curve, the parameter that moves the curves, right? Take dd epsilon of that. You get another element in the tangent space to the group, bring it back to the identity. You get somebody in the Lie algebra. Do you get everything or not? No. All you get is this, no more and no less. That's the point. So when you saw this, those of you who know Poisson or symplectic geometry say, well, you can do it only Poisson case, you know, can talk about coadjoint orbits, etc., etc. You have replaced here symplectic geometry by analysis, which is in some sense very good because you have a big tool to apply. So when we saw this, I mean, so this is fantastic. Let's go to the library, pick up a book on variational calculus, and start quoting theorems. Do you know how many theorems are about such a variation principle proved today in the literature? Zero. Anybody wants a PhD? Go ahead. Zero. Nothing. Okay. Question. If I know, if I solve the previous equations, which are just half, right? It's half variables. This is the miracle of reduction, right? Have I solved the original equation? The answer is yes. Here is an algorithm, it's a four-step algorithm, and most of it is trivial. You restrict the Lagrangian, you solve the Euler Poincaré equations. For example, if these are integrable, like the rigid body equations, you can solve them. If not, you solve them numerically. Numerically, there is a whole industry of people doing this today with discrete Euler Poincaré equations. Many, many people do this now. So such things can be, in fact, solved today numerically very well. Then you solve a linear equation with time-dependent coefficients, that's quadratures. And then here is the algorithm. If I give you an initial condition V0, it has a foot point G0, and it has a Lie algebra element Xi0 from where it comes from, right? Then V of t is equal to G0 G of t Xi of t, where Xi of t is obtained by solving this, and G of t is obtained by quadratures. That's it. I solved the original problem. Okay, so far so good. Let me give you an example. An example that you may know or you may not. KdV is a geodesic flow on Bod-Virasoro. So what is the Bod-Virasoro group? It's just a product of orientation preserving that set plus diffeomorphism of the circle times R. This is all formal at this point. I identify any such diffeomorphism with the homeomorphism of the line that goes like a helix up, right? Moves by 2 pi. And what is the multiplication? Well, obviously, it's not a direct product. I have to put a cocycle here, a group 2 cocycle, and it's psi composed with eta, alpha plus beta plus b, and this is the b, here it is, and this is the Bott-Thurston cocycle. And this has a Lie algebra, it's called the Virasoro algebra, and of course, this is as a vector space, the vector fields on the circle periodic functions, times r. The bracket is, of course, notice that I put also a minus in front of the Lie bracket here, because for other reasons I don't want to go into this, has to do with right versus left. And it has a cocycle, and the cocycle is the Gelfand-Fuchs cocycle. And here it is. Of course, historically, that's not how it was done. It was Bott and Thurston who integrated the Gelfand-Fuchs cycle to get this. Anyway, so I identify the dual with itself using the weak L2 product, right? So at this point, I just wash my hands of analysis. This is obviously not OK. I compute the coadjoint action. Here it is. And therefore, I know what the geodesics are. The geodesics are given by this expression. Notice that there is a minus here because it's on the right. I'm doing fluids here. And this is add star and not add, because add would be zero, of course. And this is the add star. And what do you get? You get these equations. And this is just Korteweg de Vries. So Korteweg de Vries is nothing else but the spatial representation of the geodesic flow of the weak L2 metric. Exactly like Arnold told us, that the Euler equations. The Euler equations are the spatial representation of the weak L2 metric on the diffeomorphism group. KdV is exactly like this, is the same thing. If you change L2 by H1, then you get Kamasa-Holm. So Kamasa-Holm is the Euler Poincaré equation, the Lie Poisson, or the spatial representation of the geodesic flow of the H1 metric on Bod-Virasoro. Okay. Now, There are coadjoint orbits here, because we talk about Bode-Virasoro. Let me tell you a little bit what's going on. Here is the pairing again. Here is the coadjoint action of the group on the algebra. And here is the first indication that there's some serious complex analysis coming in. The Schwarzian derivative that does not come for free, as we all know. And there is a constant Kirillov symplectic structure here. Constant Kirillov Suryov symplectic structure, there it is. On this coadjoint orbit, it's weak. And you want to classify. And this is the picture that was given by Balog, Fehér and Pala. It has a long history. It started with Witten, then Kirillov did, and then there were other. There were corrections. Anyway, so here is the moduli space. There are orbits here that are hyperbolic, called hyperbolic. I don't want to go into details because it's not so important. These are elliptic orbits in the open interval. There is nothing here, so it's disconnected. And these are parabolic orbits that come in triples. And this is, as the picture indicates, a non-Hausdorff space. You cannot separate this point from this point or this point from this point, but you can separate him from him. Okay? Now, among all these orbits, there is one, the first parabolic orbit, that is, in fact, the smooth version of the universal Teichmüller space. What does this have to do with KdV, etc.? I don't know. There are many open questions here, and I think some of them are quite difficult. Okay, so in order for me to tell you about universal Teichmüller space, I have to give you first a crash course in classical theory, which is already quite difficult. Then I have to tell you why it's not good. And then I have to show you what Takhtajan and Teo have done in order to get to the geodesics. So this is not going to go, this is not too easy. So I try to find the shortest way to do this, right? So I'm going to present you various facts, and then they're all going to come together. First, I need some elementary facts from function theory. So this is my Riemann sphere, the hat. This is the open unit disk. D star is the exterior of the open exterior. Then I have the L1 space, and I have the dual, the L infinity space, as usual. And these are non-separable. These are bad Banach spaces. Unfortunately, I have to deal with them. And here it's everything that is how the duality is enforced. And if I write A with 1 to infinity, these are analytic L1, analytic L infinity, etc. So this is exactly what I'm doing here. That's phi in L1D but holomorphic. This is closed. And there are various subspaces, which don't ask me why they have these indices. They are just denoted like this. One is N of D star. This is going to be a kernel of somebody. It's a null space at a certain point. You will see why. These are called infinitesimally trivial Beltrami differentials. That's the jargon. And there is a canonical splitting into a direct sum of N of D star with this space. This space is going to be important. This is L infinity, but with another measure, with a measure coming from the Poincaré disk. Right? Okay. And these are called the harmonic Beltrami differentials in this business. Right? And there is the standard duality pairing is there, and of course you can identify this by this quotient. Sometimes we have to deal with things that go to zero, and then this index zero means that when z goes to 1+, the limit is zero. Okay. So to summarize, we have various isomorphisms. This is an isomorphism, this is a Banach space isomorphism, and this is the bidual is this. You see these are non-reflexive spaces. I also need a infinity version of this. So it's holomorphic in D star such that the supremum of this relative to this measure coming from the Poincaré disk is finite. If I have a zero, again I have a limit to equal to zero. And then this space can be the omega minus 1, 1, which is going to play a major role. There's a little lemma that says that mu of z is products of this measure factor times phi z bar, complex conjugate, where phi is in A infinity of the star. A infinity of the star are these L infinity holomorphic maps. Okay. Now, I change the subject. I have to tell you about PSU1-1. So my PSU1-1 is this, just to fix notation. Of course, it's this one. It has a Lie algebra. I can write it in this fashion. And the Lie algebra, quote unquote, has a bracket. And this is the usual bracket of vector fields. Okay, change of subject. quasi-conformal maps on the disk. So I orient S1 counterclockwise. Okay, I take B1, the open unit ball in L infinity of D. So if I take phi, an orientation preserving homeomorphism that has all directional derivatives as distributions in L1 local, then phi is quasi-conformal if and only if there is a mu in B1 such that this PDE holds, this Beltrami equation holds. Now, if you have done any functions theory, of course, you know this is not the definition of quasi-conformal. It has to do with the ratios of the ellipses, how they transform. So I'm quoting here a big theorem that says that they are equivalent. This is what I need. So for me, quasi-conformal is going to be always this, ddz bar of phi is mu ddz. So here, of course, I have a problem, right? I have to start quoting something that solutions of such equations exist. I will quote in a second the relevant theorems. The point is that any quasi-conformal map extends to an orientation preserving homeomorphism of the closed disk. Okay. So finally, I come to the hero of the story. Well, what is the universal Teichmuller space? So B1 star is the open unit ball in L infinity of the exterior of the disk. So there are two models, and I need them both, unfortunately. I extend mu here by reflection in the circle. I get a new map. I still call it mu. And then I solve the Beltrami equation. Now I have to tell you what I'm doing. I want to fix the points traditionally, plus minus 1 and minus I. And this omega mu is obtained by applying the famous existence and uniqueness theorem of alphas and bears. It guarantees that such a solution exists where mu is an L infinity coefficient. Okay, and then it has beautiful properties. For example, the solution also is symmetric relative to reflection in the circle. And in addition to that, S1, D and D star are invariant under omega mu. But there is a second model. And the second model, you can do something else. You still want to solve these Beltrami equations, but you do it differently. I'm going to call it omega upper mu, right? But I want to satisfy that at zero, the value at zero is zero, the derivative at zero is one, and the second derivative is zero. And F is this holomorphic mapping, F restricted to omega mu restricted to D. So this omega mu is also obtained by the same existence and uniqueness. So by now you see that you have discovered my color scheme. Red statements are theorems, blue statements are definitions, right? So if mu and nu are in B1 star, in the unit ball of L infinity D star, then restriction of omega mu to S1 is the same as restriction to omega upper mu to the open disk. So now you define the following equivalence relation. You say that mu is equivalent to nu if and only if this happens or this happens. It doesn't matter. And the universal Teichmuller space is this quotient. Right, it's very beautiful and nice, but this is ridiculous. Right? How do you work with this? Right? So that's going to be part of the discussion. I mean, this is a monster. Okay, so what do we know? There are many, many. The best book on this is a book by Gardiner and Lakic. In the AMS surveys and monographs. It's a beautiful book. So you call this is the T1. It has a unique structure of a complex Banach manifold, such as the projection map is a holomorphic submersion. In other words, this T1 is a quotient manifold a la Bourbaki, right? That's what I'm telling you. The second one, the kernel of the tangent map, is precisely that space N that I told you before, right? That's why I called it N. From the null space. So this decomposition L infinity D star identifies the holomorphic tangent space to this with the Banach space omega minus 1, 1 in D star. And the universal Teichmuller space T1 endowed with its complex Banach manifold structure, I'm going to denote it T1b because I'm going to have another structure very soon. So this is called the universal Teichmuller space. Why? Because it contains complex submanifolds, all the Teichmuller spaces of the Fuchsian groups. The classical theory. Okay. In this theory, there is a very, very important theorem, which is called the Bears embedding. And the Bears embedding states that there is a map from here into A infinity of D. It is given in this following fashion. You take the second description, omega upper mu, you restrict to the open disk, and you take the Schwarzian derivative. And this is a map that does not depend on mu, it depends only on the class of mu. That's part of the theorem. And this is a biholomorphic mapping from T1B onto an open subset of A infinity D. Okay? In particular, let's see what this does. It's going to do something for us. In particular, the tangent map induces an isomorphism from omega minus 1,1 to A infinity of D. Ah! So the tangent space of the Teichmuller space, this is a much more friendly object, is A infinity of D. Remember that all I have to put is 1 minus z squared, the whole thing square, when I take the soup. Right? And the point is that I can compute this, and it has an explicit inverse. These are not formulas due to me by any means. This is classical theory. Right? These formulas are less important for the talk. They're important that they exist. You can compute. Okay. Now, there is another subject that I have to talk to you about, which is the quasi-symmetric homeomorphism of the circle. So now again I switch subjects. I'm going to put them together later. An orientation-preserving homeomorphism of S1 is quasi-symmetric if there is an M such that for every x and every small t, you have this estimate. So it's like a second derivative estimate, if you wish. But of course I can't talk like this because I have to take quotients. So I identify homeomorphisms of S1 with strictly increasing homeomorphisms of the line, exactly as it did before. I call QS of S1 all quasi-symmetric homeomorphisms of S1. And this is clearly a group because I can compose homeomorphisms. And, well, you have to check that the product, the composition, is again quasi-symmetric. Yes, it's true. That's not difficult. There is a big theorem here. It's the Beuerling-Alfors extension theorem. An orientation-preserving homeomorphism of the circle admits a quasi-conformal extension, which unfortunately is not unique, and it's a source of a lot of headaches, to the disk if and only if it is quasi-symmetric. Aha. So what are quasi-symmetric homeomorphisms? They're boundary values of quasi-conformal. Right? So that's already something. It follows, for example, that omega mu restricted to S1 is quasi-symmetric automatically, right? And this is just the solution of the Beltrami equation. And now I have a bijection between T1 and the quasi-symmetric homeomorphism that fixed 3 points, plus minus one and minus I. And the map is simply take the element in the Teichmuller space, solve the Beltrami equation, restrict it to the circle. This is bijective. It's a major theorem. It's a very important theorem. But now, that means that everything I have here, I can transport here, and everything that I have here, I can transport there. Right? Well, I have to wake up again. Right? For example, this is a group, and this is a manifold. So let's see what this means. It means that phi makes this into a complex Banach manifold. Just push forward the structure, right? I denote Q as B fix this complex Banach manifold. Okay? Backwards. It means that T1 is a group. This is the worst group multiplication I have seen in my life. Right? Please admire it. I have to multiply nu and mu, and in order to multiply mu and nu, I have to solve a PDE. Okay? Because this is the solution omega mu. It couldn't get worse, right? It just could not get worse. I don't know anybody who has actually checked associativity by hand. I certainly didn't. Okay? But we know it's true. But the point is that if mu is frozen, everything is beautiful. That means that relative to the Banach manifold structure, the right translations are mu are biholomorphic mappings. Just look at the formula. There is nothing to say. That's the good news. Now comes disease number one. This space is sick. Left translations are not continuous. In other words, this object here is not even a topological group. This you find in all books, all classical books, even Lecto's graduate text in mathematics states it. So this is worse than the diffeomorphism group. The diffeomorphism group, if you go Fréchet, you are fine. But who cares about Fréchet because you can't use it for PDEs. But if you go HS, you have a Hilbert manifold and a topological group, right? Here you don't even have that. So remember, disease number one, we'll have to cure it. Okay? And And there is another very, very, very strange fact going on here. And this is the following, okay, this is the warning. The computer, yeah, it's not plugged in, see, he wants to go to sleep. You say, well, QS fixed is nothing else but QS quasi-symmetric divided by PSU1-1. But PSU1-1 is not normal in there. Careful. The group structure on QS1 fixed comes from the blue. It's not what you think it is. It's not this. In other words, the projection on QS1 like this is not a group homomorphism. This is not even a group. If you think of it as a quotient. Okay. That's okay. Let's keep going to try to understand the analysis of it. Well, let me take the tangent space to understand the manifold structure. So this is given by the vector fields U on the circle that belong to the Zygmund space. That's a famous space, which is defined to be, I remind you, it's U in C0, continuous function. There is a constant C such that this estimate holds. And of course, I want to verify that it dies in 3 points. That if I want to be fixed 3 points, then I have to die to kill the vector fields in 3 points. In particular, ZS1 contains vector fields whose flows are quasi-symmetric homeomorphism. I better stop here. And this is something that is not widely known. The question that Riemann, this is not Riemann, careful. This is Riemann, Bernd Riemann, who's alive and well in Bern, right? He's retired. Mr. Riemann in the 70s has asked, is there life below Lipschitz? Right? For an analyst. We have a differential equation, we have Lipschitz right-hand side, we have flowed Lipschitz. We know Peano, but Peano's bad because you don't have uniqueness, you have no flows. Is there something more than continuous but less than Lipschitz for which you have flows? Answer yes. And the answer is, if the right-hand side is Zygmund, then the flow is quasi-symmetric. There is life below Lipschitz, and I'm going to use this. Okay. So now I can write more things down. I already mentioned this, that it's this A infinity. I can write things in Fourier coefficients. And here is something that I want you to notice for the first time around. There is an n to the power 3 that appears in A infinity. That means that he screams to me, I am here. There is an H3 over 2 that I have to look at. And this H3 over 2 will play a major role. At this point, not yet. So, the properties of this, here is the sum, the tangent space to the identity to the real Banach manifold. If I don't have fixed, it's real. If I have fixed, I have complex, is the Zygmund space. If it's the other one, it's complex and it fixes zero at 3 points. This group is not a topological group, but right translations are smooth. It contains the one fixed as a closed submanifold of codimensions 3. And I have a list of groups that we know. The C infinity diffeomorphism, the Sobolev class HS, or WSP if you want, the C1 diffeomorphism, and the quasi-symmetrics. Each one comes with his own topology. And S better be bigger than 3 over 2, because this is the critical index for diffeomorphisms in dimension 1. N over 2 plus 1, right? It's the Sobolev embedding theorem. So, this is Fréchet. This is a group of orientation preserving HS diffeomorphism with the HS Hilbert manifold structure. It's possible for this, not less. We are going to address the very modest question, what happens if it's equal, in a second. Diff C1, it's Banach. All these manifold structures are real, not complex. All of them are topological groups. This is smooth right translation, it's not a topological group. All the inclusions are smooth. Okay? Fine. All right, and I can say more. To round this all up, I said something complex. What is the complex structure? The complex structure is, in fact, the Hilbert transform. I write it either in terms of Fourier series or integral form, any way that you want. This is the complex structure in the Teichmuller space. And we finally come to the second hero of the discussion, the Weyl-Peterson metric, was introduced in 1990 by Nagan-Verhofsky, going from the classical Weyl-Peterson theorem for the classical Teichmuller spaces. And so they wrote a formula. And this formula looks very, very beautiful, right? Unfortunately, it makes no sense. This integral is divergent. Disease number two. So we have, this space is sick, right? It has two ailments. It's not a topological group, and the Weyl-Peterson metric is not a metric. I mean, you know, we can't write something that's divergent, right? Okay. However, if you look at it carefully, it does converge on another space. And does the space at which it converges, we introduced it for the first time, it's H minus 1, 1, and it's all the mu's, which are L2 relative to this, to the measure, or if you wish, it's a product of this with phi z bar, with phi in L2 analytic. Previously it was L infinity analytic. Okay, fine, so far so good. And I can write more, let's forget this. Okay, so we want to solve these two diseases. And this was solved by Takhtarjan and Teo in a series of preprints that appeared later on as a single issue in the memoirs, which is an absolutely fantastic paper. It's one of the best papers I read in many years. We have to deal with weak and strong metrics. I just remind you that weak means that the map from the space to the dual is injective, and strong means it's bijective. It's very, very rare that you have strong. If you have strong, things go very well. You'll see that it's going to happen now. So what did Takhtarjan and Teo do? Well, they looked at the Weyl-Peterson metric and said there is no way. I mean, there were many other papers by Nag, by Sullivan, who dealt with it, smooth versions of it, and all sorts of other things. But, you know, the fact is, it does not converge. There is nothing you can do about it. So then they said, well, if you can't beat them, you join them, right? So that's exactly what they did. So they took the same set, T1, and changed the manifold structure on it. Please notice that this is quite remarkable. It's not like having diff S, diffeomorphism of class HS, and of class HS plus 1. Because then if I have class of HS plus 1, I have less diffeomorphism than class HS. It's a smaller set, right? Here it's exactly the same set with a different manifold structure. So what did they say? They say, well, here is what I'm going to do. Let's look linearly. I have A2 sits in A infinity. Right? So I can think of A infinity as a manifold who also has a vector space structure, but they don't talk to each other, in such a way that it's modeled on A2. So what do you do? Here is the space, you have a subspace, and then you just add it. Put many, many on top of it. Okay? It's a manifold structure. Right? And the point is that you can do this also at the level of T1. So T1 can be produced as an A to D Hilbert manifold structure, right? And now I will denote this T1H is the same set with another manifold structure. This one is Hilbert. And on this Hilbert manifold structure, in fact, things go well. For example, do I still deal in some sense with Teichmuller? Yes. Because there is a Baer's embedding, which they proved. This is Takhtarjan and Teo. They proved that there is a Baer's embedding from the T1 with the Hilbert manifold structure in A infinity D as a Hilbert manifold. And it's given by the same formula. And it has exactly the same properties. Right? So it's exactly a typical Teichmuller theorem. They proved this. So they have the right to call it. What do they prove? They prove many, many things. Okay? Let me give you just a flavor of the most important things that they have proved, which I want to use. The Weyl-Peterson metric is strong on T1H, since it is the natural Hermitian in a product on the tangent spaces. As a consequence, the metric that goes with it and the symplectic form are also strong. Right? This one with J, the same one given by the Hilbert transform, is a strong Kähler-Einstein-Hilbert manifold, And now they prove in addition has negative constant Ricci curvature, negative sectional, and holomorphic sectional curvatures. They all prove this. The right translations are biholomorphic mappings. The connected component, now I have infinitely many connected components, uncountably many in fact, is a topological group. So they solved, they cured the first disease in the process. And the connected component of this one is the closure in T1H of wherever the diffeomorphism with the C infinity diffeomorphism of the circle goes. And the closure of this one, of the diffeomorphism that fixed 3 points, is the Hilbert manifold of quasi-symmetric homeomorphism that fixed 3 points relative to the Hilbert structure. It's perfect. It's exactly what you want. There is no free lunch. They must pay a price for it. They pay a high price for it. The price is that the classical Teichmuller spaces are included as subsets in here, but the inclusion is not continuous, let alone smooth. You can't have it both ways. Okay, I don't want to go into this. These are technicalities. Let's make some kind of a list here. This happens at tangent space level. And it's bad. So these inclusions here don't even have closed image. These inclusions here have closed images, but are not complemented. And these spaces here are co-dimension 3 in these. Please notice that here is H3 over 2, and it appears here H3 over 2 that fixes, that kills 3 points. In other words, the A2 is diffeomorphic, is isomorphic, this A2 analytic relative to the measure coming from the Poincaré disk, is isomorphic with H3 over 2. Okay? This is already something quite remarkable. I'll tell you in a second why. Here is what happens if you integrate this. These are the real spaces. Here is my Banach manifold structure. I didn't talk about the middle line. So let's forget it. These are the so-called symmetric homeomorphisms. I didn't discuss them. And these are the quasi-symmetric with their tangent spaces on the previous page. And these are the Bers embeddings here. And these are co-dimension 3 submanifolds. These are real manifolds. These are complex. Okay. So where are we? We have this space, quasi-symmetric homeomorphism of the circle, Hilbert manifold structure, fixes 3 points, connected component. So these are, any here is in fact a symmetric homeomorphism, it turns out, fixes 3 points. T is a complex Hilbert manifold and the connected topological group. Right translation are biholomorphic. The group of diffeomorphisms that fixes 3 points is dense in it. The tangent space is H3 over 2. And the Weyl-Petersen metric has all the good properties that I told you before. Now, think for a second if I do diffeomorphism groups. If I have S bigger than N over 2 plus 1 on any compact manifold, automatically the inverse is also HS by Sobolev's theorem, and therefore I have the right to talk about HS diffeomorphisms. I can always do it if S is strictly bigger than N over 2 plus 1, or if I do WSP, N over P plus 1, right? Now, I'm in dimension 1. N over 2 plus 1 is 3 over 2. 1 plus 1 half, right? So what I'm telling you, so the question is, what happens at exactly the critical index? Here is the answer. It's not by any means diffeomorphism of any kind. The tangent space is H3 over 2. The space to whom it is tangent is the universal Teichmuller space in the Takhtar-Janteau topology. It's quite unexpected. It's quite unexpected. Okay. So, this is, I'm just repeating things here. So this is exactly what I said before. If S is 3 bigger than 3 over 2, then you have this. If S is 3 over 2, well, it's not a group of diffeomorphisms, by any means. It's exactly the Teichmuller space. Okay, regularity. What can we say about regularity? Can we characterize the space, the elements which are in here? Unfortunately, no, we come close, but not completely. And it's quite difficult. So the first question that we posed, and it was answered to us by Alessio Figali, in fact, because we didn't know what to do, we thought it was known, is what happens if the right-hand side of the differential equation has regularity H3 over 2? It's bad. Here is what Figali says. Let me look at such a thing with the right-hand side H3 over 2 relative to space. Then there is a flow in L infinity of the interval in a certain class of Sobolev spaces. I will draw them for you in a second. And this is sharp, because this one doesn't do it. Right? It has a counter example. This is the best you can get. You cannot do better. So, in order for you to see what I'm talking about, this is the picture. Here is the S, here is the P, right? And everything inside here is good, everything outside is bad. That's what Figali is telling you. However, this is WSP, we are interested in H3 over 2, then it gets actually even worse, because this part is not there. And our space is exactly this corner. That's where H3 over 2 is, exactly this corner. Okay, now, the inclusion of quasi-symmetric homeomorphisms in H over 3 over 2 minus epsilon, for all epsilon, is continuous. This is a theorem that follows from Figali. Now, let's take all the HS's and intersect them for S smaller than 1/2. And I put initial topology making all these inclusions continuous. So if you want to be very precise, I can give you the neighborhoods of the identity. Here they are, right? However, the H1/2 is strictly included in this one. It's not equal to. Here is a counterexample. So now you are forced into technical results which are quite annoying at some level. Can you multiply and can you compose Sobolev functions below critical index? And the answer is yes. So here is a multiplication on the critical exponent. Here is a technical theorem. So for all epsilon and epsilon 2 such that the maximum of this is smaller than 1/2, pointwise, then the multiplication is C infinity S1, extends to a continuous bilinear map, each one with its own Sobolev topology, for all epsilon such that. In particular, pointwise multiplication in C infinity S1 extends to a continuous bilinear map in H1/2 minus, exactly the space that I introduced before. This theorem, in fact, is known, but the only proof we know of is in a book by Chemin on hydrodynamics, and the proof is quite complicated. We have a proof we didn't know about this. We have a proof that is elementary. The next result is new, as far as I know. I asked Sergio Kleinerman. He told me he didn't know it. So I assume that it's okay. So this is telling you how to compose under critical exponent. So this is a technical result. It tells you that you can compose, and it tells you that you have the correct convergence properties. Okay. Therefore, I can play the same thing with the diffeomorphism group to do 3 over 2 minus. So that all the homeomorphism orientation preserves such that both are in here. Remember, now I cannot say that if eta is there, eta minus 1 is automatically, because I don't have the Sobolev embedding theorem. And now, using the previous theorems, I can prove that the diffeomorphism of this class is a group under composition. Okay. With this topology, this one is a topological group. In addition to that, using the same theorems, the inclusion of the quasi-symmetric homeomorphism in the Hilbert manifold structure is continuous. We would like to, okay, so we know already where it sits, right? But there is no, sure we know who it is, it's for the Teichmuller space, right? But this is not humane, right? I can't put my hands on it, I can't verify, I can't check something with estimates, right? It's not known. Here is a conjecture, for example, which you could never prove. Given u of t in C0, there exists a C1 curve, such that eta dot is equal to this. You say, but of course it's true. I completely agree. Based on religious grounds, it better be true, right? It's the exponential map of a group, right? How could this not exist, right? You need to prove something, and it doesn't work. But if it is true, these three are theorems, then this one contains exactly the flows of the time-dependent vector fields in here. I know exactly a major improvement on Figali's result. Okay, there exists an eta which is not in 3 over 2. And for all 3 over 2, we have that the diffeomorphisms are inside here, for all s is bigger than 3 over 2. But we don't know whether this is continuous or not. We didn't try very hard because this is, but I don't know what to do about this. Anyway, it should be true, but I don't know what to do. There is a Lie algebra structure. Here it is. And I want to recall for you a theorem of Paley. This is again something that is not known. We all learn that there is the Schauderring, that if you have HS, 1 times HS2, you multiply them, you are in H of min S1, S2, if S1 and S2 are bigger than n over 2 plus 1. Right? But in fact, the result, this is a corollary of a result that's tougher. It says here that if T is strictly bigger than n over 2, and R is bigger than or equal to minus T, then this multiplication extends to a multiplication in this way. This is the best result I know that's classical. It's in Paley's book on Foundations of Global Analysis. Okay, so now we have the objects, we studied the regularity as much as we could, we have a metric, therefore what do? We do geodesics, right? So, the question is, I have a metric, it is strong, what can I say about the metric? A lot. The Riemannian manifold, this is the Nag Verhofsky, this is the Weil-Peterson metric, is geodesically complete. The geodesic spray, call it Z, of the metric GH is smooth, and there is an associated Levi-Civita connection, the curvature and Ricci tensor bounded operator, that is Takhtajan and Theo, and they even give you who's Ricci relative to the metric, the Gentakhtajan and Theo, right? So the question is, let's go back to the first slide, what is the spatial representation? So you say, well, I know what to do, right? I have a formula. Poincaré gave me the formula. So here is the formula. All I have to do is compute, right? It's not so difficult after all. This is L is just a kinetic energy. I have to restrict to H3 over 2. Here it is. I write it down. And this is my Euler Weil-Peterson Lagrangian. And I want to write everything down. It better all make sense, and it does make sense. You have to be a little bit careful. It's not totally obvious, because the Lagrangian is given in terms of an operator on U, and this operator actually is not elliptic. You can check. But it's very close to being elliptic. So if it you can write it this down. Here you see again the 3 over 2. You see, this 3 over 2 shows everywhere up. And it has properties. It goes from HS to HS minus 3. If it's in HS, then U is in HS, but it's regularizing. The kernel is just the Lie algebra of the quasi of PSU on 1. And the image of the operator is this one. It turns out then that this one is an isomorphism. So the conclusion, L is well defined here. So I have written something that makes sense. Okay, so the Lagrangian makes sense. The kinetic energy makes sense. Good. Let's write the Euler-Poincaré equations down. So you write them down formally. So here they are. This is the coadjoint action, where M is this operator on U. The functional derivative you can prove is this way. And therefore, the Euler-Weil-Peterson equation is this. This is the Euler-Poincaré equations for the Weil-Peterson metric. Okay? Big problem. This makes no sense. This is illegal. This equation absolutely makes no sense. You multiply things that you are not allowed to multiply. Okay? And you can try it in any way or shape you want. It won't work. I try to use Paley. Here is Paley. The theorem does not apply. Try the weak form. Ain't working. Because you have to pair this with this. Doesn't work. Right? However, I want to remind you that these two difficulties do not occur in Kamasa-Holm or the Euler or the average Euler, the so-called Euler alpha model, right? Because the CH equation is like this, and it has the same Q-op, in fact, like ours. But here, things make sense. You have to be careful, and they do make sense. In our case, it does not. So what are the equations? They must exist. And sure enough, they exist. There is a geometric form of the Euler-Weyl-Petersen equation, and I'm going to give it to you in a second. So I'm taking gamma xt, a Weyl-Petersen geodesic, for where x is in S1 and t is time. And I think of it as a curve in H3 over 2. It is smooth because the spray I just told you is smooth. And so therefore, gamma and gamma double dot are well defined. So because I have a smooth spray, I have a, here it is, I call it z, and I can write it. It's gamma double dot plus capital gamma of gamma dot equal to 0, where this operator is well defined, and this replaces the Christoffel symbols. That's why I call it gamma. It's like the Christoffel symbols in finite dimensions. So by definition, I have that the derivative is, in fact, a vector field. And this does make sense. Everything is fine. Because in Takhtar-Janteau's theory, this is a group. And right multiplication is smooth. And the tangent space is H3 over 2. Everything is legal that I'm doing here. So if I would be a mechanician, and I would say, now I'm working in this material or Lagrangian representation, I have no problem. Everything is fine. But if I go to space, I have big problems. And in fact, what you get is a theorem of this type. Let gamma t be your geodesic of the Weyl-Petersen metric. Then the continuous curve, this one, that sits necessarily in H3 over 2, is continuously differentiable as a curve in H1 half. And this derivative is given in this fashion. So there is a form that goes with the spatial representation of the Euler-Weyl-Petersen equation, but it involves this geodesic spray. However, if you have additional regularity, then those equations do make sense. Okay, so that's perfectly possible. Now, I think my time is out, I assume. I will not tell you about pattern recognition, but there is a very, very, very interesting application. It's due to Mumford. Mumford has been interested in the past years for to computer vision, to recognize images. So let me make a joke out of it. It's very simple. We are going to come to the point where we are not having a pin code. We just put your finger, right? Those of you who have been to China already know this is happening, even in amusement parks. It's your thumb that opens everything, right? So that's going to happen later. Or even less, it just looks at you. You go in front of the ATM machine, it looks at you. Now, you took your picture 5 years ago, you were dressed like me. 5 years have passed, and you come from a party at 4 in the morning. So obviously, you do not look the same, right? So how does the machine know that it's you, right? So this is a very, very good question. So that means the machine has to minimize certain things, right? So it wants to minimize shapes. The obvious thing that you would like to do, you use L2 metrics, right? What else could you do? Bad news. For the L2 metric, the distance function that goes with the weak L2 metric is not a distance function. You can have two different diffeomorphisms at distance zero from each other. This is bad. There's a problem, right? But you say, how is this possible? But it's possible. The metric was weak. Your theorem that you know from Riemannian geometry will not work. It will break down because the metric is weak. Okay? So they were looking for another metric for curves in the plane. Well, here it is. It's the Weyl-Petersen metric. So they're using the Weyl-Petersen metric to have pattern recognition. In the process of doing this, at a certain point, they were forced to consider the problem that in each homotopy class between two shapes, there is exactly one Weyl-Petersen geodesic. And they stated it as a conjecture. Using what I just told you, this is a corollary of the theorems that I gave you before. And there are other applications, but let me stop here. Thanks.